But that said, let me tell you what these 4 years actually mean. I wanted to think about giving you a certain goal, like what is it that you are going to learn over here? And it was very nicely conveyed by the Vice Chancellor in his talk, where he said that, you know, you're there to build a knowledge base using scientific inquiry. The most important thing that you're learning is not going to be the foundational aspects of your field, etc. The most important thing that you're going to learn is how to look at the world through a scientific lens. When you look at something, the great thing about science is that science is one place where you'll find the least amount of disagreement. We all agree 1 + 1 = 2, right? We may not agree on 101 other things, but science is a place of agreement because all of us agree that there are a certain set of principles with which you arrive at the best version of the truth. And studying science and studying engineering and studying all those complex equations and studying all those derivations, it basically trains your mind to think scientifically. That will be the number one contribution of this course to you. So many times you will be sitting around and you'll be thinking, what am I learning right now? How is this going to help me in future? Is this particular thing that I'm learning, when I get a job tomorrow, is somebody going to ask me a question from this textbook? No, they're not going to ask you anything from that textbook. But they are going to talk to you and they're going to relate to you and they're going to work with you because they understand that you're coming from a place, you're coming from an experience that values scientific inquiry. Second thing is that these 4 years, you're starting today, these 4 years are the final opportunity for you to shape your personality without serious consequences. This is the last 4 years of your life where you can afford to make mistakes and get away with it. After this point of time, you'll be entering the responsible world where people will start looking up to you for assistance. They will start looking up to you for help. So you'll have families, you'll be fathers and mothers. You'll be having to take care of your family. Your family is going to be funding your education now, but you're going to have to take care of your parents. So you're going to become responsible after these 4 years. So after these 4 years are over, your freedom to make mistakes will slowly start coming down because your mistakes will have consequences. I'm not saying that your mistakes won't have consequences here, but what I'm trying to say is here you can afford to try and fail. And that's not a privilege that you will have later. I don't have that privilege today. I cannot try whatever I want and say, okay, let it succeed if it does. I have to be very careful with what I do. So these are the final 4 years where you can face your fears without worry. What is the worst that could happen, right? Let's say you decide to dance on this stage in a cultural program. You've never danced in your life before. What is the worst that could happen? A few hundred people, 99 of which you will never see again after 4 years, may laugh. That's all. That's the only price you may pay, right? There's a sports field outside. You may have never been involved in sports, but these 4 years are your opportunity to pick up a sport and try to be really good at it. What's the worst that could happen? There'll be a race in which you may come last or second last. That's the worst thing, but you would still be a better sports person. You could write something, you could read something, you could work on a small film. Now these are all the things I'm saying outside of your main course. Things that will help you develop your personality. No matter how well you are, how many great marks you're getting in, say, digital signal processing, that's not going to affect your personality. Right? So these are the 4 years where you can work on all of these different things without major worry. You won't get this opportunity again, so utilize it to the extent that you can. You have so many great facilities here. Just from the time that I was here, I moved out of Crescent in 2008. We never had this auditorium was there. It got completed during our time. We didn't have a canteen with so much, with so many branded outlets that were available. I was so surprised when I came here a year and a half. I just turned up over here and I was really surprised. We didn't have a bookstore. We didn't have any swimming pool or any arrangement with the school at that point of time. There are so many things that have changed. We didn't have an ATM over here. There are a lot of things that have changed. There are a lot of extra facilities that you have. Utilize those facilities to the extent possible. And be careful about a few things. People will keep telling you, right? Some people may tell you that if you're not interested in this, you don't have to give it too much attention. If you're not interested in engineering, don't just take it easy, take it casual, you know, finish your 4 years, some way or the other. After that, do what you really love. We should do things only that we are very passionate about. If you're not passionate about engineering, let it. It's not a problem. Some people will tell you that, right? And those people would be lying to you. Because the fact is, in your life, you will not be able to do things that you like all the time. even if you get to do what you like, there will be parts of what you like that you will not like. Okay, I'll give you an example. Let's say that one of you here is a budding filmmaker. Day in and day out, you're watching stuff on your phone. You're always watching movies. You're analyzing movies from a perspective of a director. You have 10 scripts in your mind, but unfortunately, life has given you engineering. So then you may have this dream that somehow I'll finish these 4 years, and then I will become a filmmaker. Then my sun will rise. You'll think that, but what will happen at that point? Let me tell you. When you start doing your filmmaking after 4 years of taking your engineering very casually, because this is not that important. This is not something I like so much. Even when you make movies, there will be parts of filmmaking that you will like, there will be parts of filmmaking that you don't like. You may really like direction, going out, finding sets, getting actors, telling them to act a certain way, shooting. You may really like that. But then you will also have to do editing, you will also have to do soundtrack mixing. You will have to sit down with editors day in and day out to try to make your film. And if you have an attitude that I will do only what I enjoy, you will not enjoy the editing process. You will not do proper editing. And your film will be a useless film. No matter what you do in your life, there will always be things that you will like. For example, let's say you're a very passionate sports person or cricketers, and you're thinking in your mind that, you know, this is all that I need. Even in cricket, you may be a great batsman. You may like batting, but at the same time, if you don't do your daily morning exercise, and if you don't do your stretches every day, and if you don't do your strengthening every day, if you don't do your bodybuilding every day, if you don't do that, you will not be a good cricketer. You can say, I like only batting, I'm a great passionate batsman, so I'll only bat. That only works in street cricket, not in the real world. So please remember, no, you cannot be a person who only waits for what you like. If you are that person, you will find life very difficult. So this is the place where you are going to train yourself. Even if you are an enthusiastic engineer, which most of you here would be people who like this subject, even then there will be certain papers you will not like. Does that mean that you ignore that altogether? No. People who succeed, if they like history, they do well in geography also. If they like physics, they do well in chemistry also. Right? Those people succeed. They are the toppers. And remember, they are not toppers because they know physics and chemistry and history and geography, which everybody else knows. They are toppers because they come with a mindset which says that this person will do what needs to be done. If you are an employer tomorrow, there was a lot of emphasis on employment in the previous speeches over here. If you are an employer tomorrow, what kind of person would you want to employ? A person who does what needs to be done, or a person who does what he likes to do? You'll obviously employ the person who does what needs to be done because it needs to be done. And that characteristic, that mindset, unfortunately, if you start picking this up later, you will go through unnecessary turbulence in your life. So I would say get used to that here. And the most important thing that I would like to emphasize, which really runs the world, you know, it's the currency of the world outside, is character. You may be a great genius, you could be a science whiz, but if you don't have sound character, nobody will want to work with you. If nobody works with you, you will be sitting alone in a room writing papers. You will not be able to make the necessary networks to display your knowledge outside. And what do I mean by character? Very simple things. Compassion should be part of your personality. What is compassion? I was going to tell you this, but this was already mentioned by the Vice Chancellor in his speech, where he said, treat everybody else the way you want to be treated. Very simple thing. It's a very simple thing. What does a person who treats everybody else the way he or she wants to be treated, what kind of a person is that? Simple person. It's a person who if he gets ragged in first year, he does not rag somebody when he's in second year. That's all. A person who will treat others the way he or she wanted to be treated. You don't want to be ragged today, do you? You do? You don't, right? That means tomorrow when you have an opportunity to do that, you will not do that. Why? Because you're not a hypocrite. But how many people who get ragged in first year, move to second year and do the same thing? What does that tell you? It tells you that something as simple as treating other people the way that you want to be treated is not as common as we think it should be. What does that also mean? It means that if you simply follow this simple principle of treating others the way you want to be treated, you will set yourself apart from the rest. It's not very difficult to do at all. Right? So that is one basic aspect. Integrity. What is integrity? The way you are on the inside, you be on the outside. Very simple. When I meet you and I talk to you, you present the real version of yourself to me. You don't present another version to me, then go and present another version to somebody else, then another personality for somebody else. That's a person without integrity. Is this very hard to do? It's not very hard to do. But trust me, when you're looking for people with integrity, when you become future employers, you will find this is a problem. You will appreciate not the person who's the biggest genius in your company, you'll appreciate the person with the most integrity. Why? Because what he has told me is what he feels is true. Please remember that good marks, great university medals, trophies are not a substitute for character. You can be a topper, but at the same time be somebody who is extremely jealous at the success of other people. You could be a person who has presented papers at multiple international forums, but you could also be a person who continuously gossips behind other people's back. These two things can exist together. But if they exist together, you will actually be denying yourself the opportunity to really utilize your potential, because you will keep rejecting people. The world, the way it works today, is it is all teamwork. You will be as successful. Let me put it this way. If you ask me what would it be the largest determinant of your success 10 years from now, I would define it in a very simple line, and I would say that the extent to which you can work with people you don't know. The extent to which you can work well with people you don't know will determine how far you go in life. And how do you work well with people you don't know? By just being a nice person, by being a compassionate person, by being a forgiving person. You will not believe this, but if you actually go to the Office of Personnel Management, okay, that's a department in the United States government which hires people for positions where they report directly to the people at the level of the President of the United States. So at the highest level in the United States administration, what do we have? You have the President, you have the Secretary of State, you have the Defense Secretary, you have the Cabinet, right? It's a very interesting thing. Executive core qualities are listed out, saying that we want people with these qualities to apply for this important job. Do you agree that it's an important job? Yes or no? One more thing you should learn is if somebody asks a question, you can answer. Yes or no? Yes? I can't tell you. Yes. Okay. So these are the qualities that are listed out. You know what those qualities are? They don't say you should have a university gold medal. They don't say you should have 3 PhDs. They don't say any of that. They say very basic things like should have the ability to build teams. Should have the ability to create team spirit among people. My favorite thing in that list, it says should have the ability to leverage diversity. What does that mean? It means that in this room right now, if there are 500 or 1000 students here, all of you are different. All of you come from different backgrounds. All of you don't come from a similar background. Some of you speak English very well, some of you maybe not so much. Some of you may belong to very rich families, some of you not so much. Some of you may be from Chennai, some may be from outside Chennai. Some of you may belong to one religion, some may belong to another religion. So there is this diversity. People who can leverage diversity. What does that mean? It means recognizing that we live in a society that everyone is different, and because they are different, they have something unique to offer. So when you say people are different, you don't say, oh, we should all try to be the same. No, no, no. Because everybody is different, they have a unique perspective to offer. Which means that if you have a problem in front of you, those different people will look at the same problem through different ways. And a combination of that will be the best solution to the problem. Problem of plastic, for example. Right? Anyway, so my point is, people who can leverage diversity are appreciated all over the world. And can you leverage diversity without character? You cannot. So please build on that for the coming 4 years. I would like to conclude by mentioning something that you can, something that was again mentioned, I think this time it was mentioned by the registrar in his speech, where he said you study for 2 hours every day. Then my dear professor Khaja Mohandeen sir came and reduced it to 1.5 hours. I'm really proud that they feel you can do that for 2 hours. I can't study for 2 hours every day. It's not possible. I would say you challenge yourself to do something for 20 minutes every day. Start with that. 20 minutes every day you devote to something. My request to all of you would be, if I ask you, I'll give you a fill in the blank. Okay, I do dash every day. Very simple. I do dash every day. Can you fill up that blank with something that is not mandatory? For example, I do eat breakfast every day. I do go to the toilet every day. I do brush my teeth every day. I do eat lunch every day. These are things everybody, I do wear clothes every day, I do, maybe not everybody, but I do bathe every day, whatever. These are things you have to do. Can you fill up that blank with something you don't have to do, but something that you want to do? Can you do that? How many of you in this room can fill up that blank with something you do every day that is not compulsory? There will be very few of you. Maybe once a week, maybe 7 days in 1 week, then 7 weeks gap. Right? That's the kind of mindset that we have. But please get yourself to be able to fill up this blank every day. Okay? If you can do that, you will realize something very, very, very important. The most important lesson that you could learn in life, I would say, is that all great things start with something small. And when something small accumulates over a period of regular time, then it turns into something great. You have to start small. It has to be built up regularly. It need not be every day, but it has to be regular. Every alternate day, at least. It has to be regular in nature. If you do something regularly over a long period of time, you will achieve things you never thought you could achieve. That's how I got into the civil service. If you look at my performance in college, I was not the topper of my class, which does not mean I was second. I wasn't even in the top 10 or top 15 of my class. Okay, but there was a reason for that. It was not because I was unintelligent or I was stupid or I was... That was not the reason. The reason was very simple. I was not giving as much time I should to my subjects. If I had done that, I would have finished in the top 5, top 10, maybe even number 1. I used to focus a lot of studying before my exam. The exam is coming up, 2 days holidays, start now. Right? Many of you will have that center, will face that situation, and you will tell yourself, and your mind will tell you something. It will tell you, from next semester onwards, I will study every day. And then you will be in front of your 8th semester, saying, okay, it's too late now. So don't be in that position. Study every day. Spend 20 minutes. Or at least, even if you can weekly, if you can focus on your subjects, you will do very well. But you should have something apart from your engineering. You can't walk away after 4 years only having an engineering degree in hand. That would be unfair to the institution that you are studying in, because this institution is giving you so much opportunity. You should be more than that. Whenever a complicated subject comes in front of you, remember, you don't need that subject in future. But what you need is the ability to learn something complicated, because life is going to be full of complications. And your training in how to assess, how to approach complicated issues in your college, in an atmosphere where you're safe, in an atmosphere where you can afford to fail, that will help you much later. So I do dash every day is something that all of you should be able to fill up, and that will be the solution to all your problems. Trust me on that. That will be the solution to all your problems, because once you realize this, that if I devote my time and my energy every day for a small period of time, if I do that continuously, I can achieve the impossible. You will realize that. I realized that as a civil servant. I moved to Delhi and I started studying every day. Okay, so every day I used to sit down and I used to read. And remember, 80% of doing something is to get started. 80% of working out, 80% of getting a physique is not working out in the gym. It is reaching the gym. Putting your shoes, reaching the gym. Most difficult thing to do. Once you reach the gym, everything is fine. Most difficult part about studying is not the studying part. It is reaching the table. Once you reach the table and you open your book, something or the other will start going. Getting started is the most important thing. I did that for 6 months. Believe me, when I went to Delhi, I never thought that I would ever end up in the top 500 of this country. I never thought. Why? I was not finishing in the top in my own class. How would I suddenly do that? So when my first result came out, I was really shocked. So how did this happen? I couldn't believe my eyes. I had a 5-digit serial number. I read the serial number from front to back, back to front. Then I was staying as a tenant. So I called my landlord and said, "Uncle, ye number padhi hai. Read this number and tell me if this is the right number." And then we both agreed that it was my serial number. So when I had that moment, I had to look back and wonder, what did I do? What did I do that was so correct? How did this happen? It was not a fluke that I knew. And the simple solution was, the only thing I did was, I didn't worry about anything else. I reached the table every day and I studied. And because of that, I got extraordinary results. And from that point onwards in my life, any time I've been faced with any challenge, my personality immediately kicks in and says, no problem, start small. Big problem in front of you, start small. You can't solve everything in a day. You can't do anything in a day, actually. Right? So, that lesson I want all of you to learn. I'll give you a final tip and then conclude my speech. If you are still worried about what to do for those 20 minutes, all of you have smartphones, all of you have Jio Wi-Fi, you have Jio and the college is providing you Wi-Fi. Great. There's a very interesting app called Duolingo. How many of you have heard of this app? One. What is this? This or this? One. Two, three, four. Each one is getting more guts seeing other hands raised. Never mind. Okay, so just download this app on your phone. It allows you to learn 28 foreign languages using English as a base. You can even learn Hindi if you want. You could learn any language, and all it takes, the most interesting thing, that app gives you an offer. It tells you, do you want to learn 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, 15 minutes a day, or 20 minutes a day? There is no option to study more than 20. Okay, 5, 10, 15, or 20. And each time is given a name. Okay, so for example, 5 minutes is called casual. 10 minutes is called regular. 15 minutes is called serious. That means 15 minutes a day if you study, then you are a serious person. You know what 20 minutes a day is called? Maximum. It's maximum. You know what it's called? Remember, this is the world's most used language app, which means it is analyzing the mindset of people all over the world and then making this category. They are understanding that millions of people in the world are not able to give more than 15 minutes. That if they give 15 minutes, they are serious people. That's all. To be a serious person, you need to give 15 minutes. Do you know what is 20? Can anyone tell me? Sorry? Extraordinary. That's actually a lower than what the actual name is. Anybody? No? It's called insane. Insane. So if you select 20 minutes a day, that app thinks you are insane. You have to be mad to be able to give 20 minutes a day. And why are they saying that? Because that's where the world averages. So to be super insane, 25 minutes a day, that's it, you're done. You'll be ahead of millions of people all over the world. So that's how simple it is. I wish you all the best. And I want to thank the college again, not only for inviting me and giving me this honor, but also for the 4 years that I spent over here. I had a great time the 4 years that I stayed. One thing I always appreciated about the institution is it gave us the freedom, the absolute necessary amount of freedom, I would say, in order to express ourselves, in order to do things that we wanted to do, in order to succeed, in order to fail. It gave us great infrastructure. It gave us this stage. I was a very regular person on the stage. A lot of you may be thinking that, okay, this person is speaking with so much confidence. Remember, the practice came here. Wasn't born with this. Right? So, each space over here gives you an opportunity. I utilized those opportunities. I wish I had done better at electronics and communication. I still regret it sometimes when I'm sitting in a room and then somebody comes up with a... I'm sitting in a room with some senior officers and then there's a discussion on some advanced electronics thing. I usually am like, okay, I'll listen over here. You know, I don't have much to offer on the thing. I wish that wasn't always the case. I end up spending more time trying to understand concepts, but please don't do like don't do that. Have a great time, but please give importance to your subject as well. Not because you like it or you don't like it or you're passionate or you're dispassionate, but simply because it's something that you need to do and it needs to be done. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, sir. It's not joy that makes us grateful, it is gratitude that makes us joyful. I now request Dr. S. Kuttirani, Dean, School of Physical and Chemical Sciences and First Year Coordinator, to propose vote of thanks.
Very good morning to one and all present here. I have a pleasant duty of proposing thanks to the percentage who contributed for the successful conduct of this orientation program for first year B.Tech. At the outset, I would like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is always ready to guide and support us with his sharp intellectual acumen, for delivering the presidential address and motivating the students. Thank you, sir. Our sincere thanks are due to our beloved Registrar, Dr. Asad sir, for being the source of encouragement and support in all our academic endeavors. Thank you, sir. I express our profound gratitude to our distinguished alumnus, Mr. Bin Mohammed Ali IAS, for having accepted our invitation amidst his busy schedule and graced the occasion by his inspiring address. Thank you, sir. I would like to place on record the guidance rendered by our Deputy Registrar, Dr. Raja Hussain, sir. Our grateful acknowledgements are due to our Dean Academics, Dean Student Affairs, Dean School of Electrical and Communication Sciences, and Men's Hostel Warden for their qualitative inputs in the area of academic structure, student support activities, and facilities in the hostel.